Hi, this is Scott Wilkinson, host of Home Theater Geeks. In episode 207, I chat with streaming mavens Barb Gonzalez and Mark Henninger about Amazon Fire TV, net neutrality, and a new service called Qplay. So stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Home Theater Geeks is provided by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Home Theater Geeks with Scott Wilkinson, recorded May 22nd, 2014. Episode 207, The Streaming Steamroller. This episode of Home Theater Geeks is brought to you by NatureBox, where you can order great-tasting, healthy snacks delivered right to your door. Forget the vending machine and get in shape with healthy, delicious treats like apple pie oat clusters. To get 50% off your first box, go to naturebox.com/twit. That's naturebox.com/twit. Hey there, Scott Wilkinson here, the home theater geek and editor of avsforum.com. This week, I have two guest geeks on the show. First is Barb Gonzalez, the simple tech guru, a freelance writer for Sound and Vision magazine and various other websites and outlets all over the place. Hey, Barb, welcome back to the show.
Oh, it's always good to be on. Thanks for having me, Scott.
You bet. Also, we have Mark Henninger, the senior writer at AVS Forum, my right-hand man there, and general bon vivant and man about town. Hey, Mark, welcome back.
Thanks a lot, Scott.
So those of you who are logged into the chat room at irc.twit.tv or watching live at live.twit.tv can post questions for us as we go along, and I'll pass along as many as I can. Now, the topic for today is online entertainment, shall we say. Streaming, mostly, I think. And there are a number of interesting news items that have occurred recently and products that have been introduced that I would just like to get some updates from. And Barb and Mark are both my go-to folks for streaming content and all that kind of stuff. Let's start with the recent news that the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, recently voted to consider new rules that they call open internet. Now, they imposed or approved some rules like this a couple of years ago, and an appeals court struck it down in January for one reason or another. And I would love to get your guys hit on that and what the new rules mean, if anything different. Barb, let's start with you.
Well, it's such a complicated issue. There's just so much about the whole thing. And the rules you were talking about were from 2010. And the what happened in January was a case where Verizon wanted to offer some fast lane or some preferential treatment for certain websites over other websites, with the idea that it's going to slow down the other websites. And the court said that the FCC didn't have the authority to make these rules. So a lot of things are happening in this new NPRM that was proposed a couple weeks ago. And the NPRM meaning, we figured this out, what was it? Notice of proposed rulemaking.
Notice of proposed rulemaking. NPRM.
That's correct. And right. The thing about it is that it's not. They voted to propose this, but it's really a bunch. Really, all this document is a bunch of questions to the public and to industry insiders to say, is this the way we should go? Are these the rules we should make? So it's really important to make comment on it, because it's all about allowing the internet to continue to be free and being a watchdog over the internet providers so that they can't get away with saying, oh, whether there was too much traffic or something, rather than it be the truth, which is that they were actually slowing it down so that, like, Verizon could let Redbox get through or what have you.
Let's make very clear here that that now is the time for the public to weigh in. And you can do that in a couple of ways. You can go to the FCC website, or you can even email them. And I want to direct people to my website, avsforum.com. On the homepage is an article, a link to an article about this subject. Within the article are links to those places where you can go and voice your opinion and say whether or not you think this is a good idea or a bad idea.
And Scott, I also have just posted on my Simple Tech Guru site a bunch of what the questions were specifically from the NPRM.
Excellent, because probably reading the NPRM is not an easy slog.
It's not fun, but there's like a lot of the questions are real straight questions. Do you think that the internet providers are doing a good job of letting you know why the internet is slowing down? Should we be able to measure it? Should they have to tell you why things are slowing down and have a place where you can find out what the data is and all different things like that? So I copied a bunch of that stuff. Right now, I've just thrown it up on the Simple Tech Guru site, and you can go there and there's all the links for where to comment for the NPRM, as well as there's also the other part going on, which is that some people in Congress are trying to take away their authority and trying to block this new reclassification to Title II. And so people need to write to their congressman and say, hey, don't block this reclassification. We need to have regulation because we don't have competition in our areas.
Mm. Mark, what's your hit on this whole issue?
Well, I do live in what's probably ground zero for this, Philadelphia, where Comcast is headquartered. The take I have is that this country needs more municipal internet. Maybe it is nice to ask the free market to behave well, but even with government regulation, I suspect that the shenanigans would continue, and that to go back to Philadelphia, it was a few years ago that we really thought we were going to get a public Wi-Fi system in the city, and for some reason that faltered. Probably has nothing to do with Comcast whatsoever. And in the end, I think that people who are there already is a tiered system. I mean, you already pay for bandwidth, and the providers are likely to be biased towards customers who pay more for extra bandwidth, and they don't want to hear those customers complain that they can't play Netflix. And if you have the bottom tier plan, they want to be able to say to you, well, hey, upgrade and your problems will be solved. So, given that the government can't police everything, as well as it would like to, and there are more serious issues that they are also failing to police, my take is that municipal internet is actually the direction that would ultimately, benefit the most people.
Now, does that mean that the city, say Philadelphia or Los Angeles or Petaluma, where Twit is, wherever, would provide free internet, or it would be a public utility like the gas company or the electric bill?
Right, because if the most extreme version of net neutrality is having the government run the internet like a utility to begin with. But yes, all the issues currently appear to be in what they call the last mile, or where getting that content from Netflix's server through the cable provider to the home, that's where the blockages are occurring. And it does seem to be that the cable companies or the broadband providers are deliberately creating some traffic jams. I mean, there's currently arguments about that. So one way to alleviate that is to create a municipal internet with a universal access standard. It doesn't have to be free. It could be, I guess it could be paid for with taxes in my fair, humble opinion.
Well, certainly there will be a debate about that. But
yes,
Barb, this, I guess, goes back to what you were talking about, Title II, which is part of the Telecommunications Act. I think the original one was 1930-something, and then it was updated in the 90s, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong there.
Sorry, I bet the dog's in the back.
Yeah. Good doggy. This Telecommunications Act regulates what are called common carriers, right? So the phone company and I guess the electric company, although it's telecommunications, so it would be the phone company. Never mind. The internet currently is not classified under that same category, isn't it?
Exactly. I mean, that's the whole thing, is it's kind of about being a public utility kind of thing. And they say that 87% of Americans use the internet. And it really is like a lot of what Mark was talking about, you know, that it should be a public utility. And so the reclassification is that broadband internet providers come under that sort of public utility classification, so that there is the authority for the FCC to take action and regulate. And I mean, Mark's proposals are wonderful, but we have to deal with what we have right now. And we'd be fighting a really big uphill battle to try to take everything away from all the Comcasts and everything else. So we need to put some Band-Aids on, and we need to make sure that the public is well aware of all the shenanigans that they're pulling.
Mm. Which is where you and Mark and I come in by writing about all this kind of stuff, right?
Yes. But we have to know what it really is. I mean, we can only speculate that they're slowing things down and saying that there's lots of traffic when it's convenient for them. A lot of the proposals is asking, how do we go about really letting people know at any given time, a place I can go to say, is this because of traffic, or is this because Redbox needs to get some more streaming power?
Well, this is a big question. The chairman of the FCC, Tom Wheeler, made a big point of saying, I do not want to sacrifice bandwidth. I don't want ISPs, internet service providers, to sacrifice bandwidth for some providers, content creators and providers, at the expense of, or in order to make room for others. On the other hand, the proposed rules, I think, do include a provision whereby it's called the fast lane, whereby internet content providers can pay ISPs like Comcast to give them more bandwidth for their content, which to me would seem to mean that you'd have to take it from somewhere. There's only a finite amount of bandwidth, right?
Well, and that's what I kind of also want to think about, too. Okay, so in the evening, in peak hours, in the NPRM, they state that Netflix takes up 67% of the traffic in the peak hours. When Netflix takes over that much, everything slows down. They're already slowing down the rest of the internet so that Netflix can come to you, right?
Right.
I mean, that it's just because, like you said, there's only so much bandwidth. But I think that one of the things that they're hoping for is that by saying no other, if you give a fast lane to one person, no other website can be slowed down below what people are paying for, what they're subscribing for. So, I'm going to get my 100 megabits per second. Well, that would be wonderful. But,
yeah,
you know, allowing all these other ones. But in order for that to happen, it's going to require some build out in that last mile, like Mark was talking about, and infrastructure will have to happen in order to open up the pipe so that there's more room for everybody else. And I think that this is kind of a kind of implied way, you know, to put it out there that they're going to have to start building things out and start giving us Google Fiber.
Mark, I don't know if you saw last week's show. I was talking with Andrew Cross at NewTek, and we were talking about some of these same issues about building out the last mile and how the infrastructure of the internet overall needs to be increased, updated in order to accommodate so much more traffic that we expect with video streaming. I mean, just talking about UHD streaming, 4K streaming, will require a massive amount of more of bandwidth than we currently have capacity for, don't you think?
It doesn't seem like bandwidth is as scarce as it's made to seem. You know, Google doesn't seem to have a hard time supplying that gigabit at under $100 a month. So
only where they've laid the fiber, though. I mean,
sure,
that requires that, you know, as Andrew said, a hard hat and a shovel and a backhoe and, you know, some real people doing real work, laying, you know, digging trenches and laying that Google. And how many cities is it in now?
But what has Comcast done to get up to 150 megabits, you know, at my house through copper? It just doesn't seem like it's that impossible. And that the arguments I've seen flying around on the internet, including one that I wrote an article about, seem to be that it's the middlemen who are accusing, you know, the ISPs of just deliberately creating the bottleneck, and that the bottleneck doesn't really exist.
Interesting. An LE guy in the chat room is asking, so does Barb mean that Netflix needs its own internet at 4K?
Well, I mean, I don't like anything preferential, but if they're already taking so much of the internet, shouldn't they have to pay? If they're paying for extra, maybe that extra money that they're paying can go towards infrastructure that could allow the rest of the internet to speed up.
Well,
you know, who knows?
Mark, go ahead.
Well, if we're talking about Netflix being the problem because of its size, then there could be an alternate solution. Netflix could get its data, you know, instead of an over the top, it could get it almost like a dedicated channel. Like you subscribe to cable, you subscribe to HBO, you can also subscribe to Netflix and get the data like it was an on-demand service. I don't think that's impossible. And that's basically a fast lane without using the public internet.
Oh, so you're saying that though, that they would have to build out their own physical infrastructure in order to deliver that?
I don't know the technical challenges, but, you know, let's say Comcast is delivering video games through streaming. Why can't they deliver Netflix through streaming? Through their existing on-demand, video on-demand network, which really isn't the internet. It's just bandwidth to your home. It's
I see.
It's
using the Comcast.
Yes.
Got it. Well, that's an interesting idea. I've heard it said that if everybody on the internet started streaming Netflix at the same time, the internet would crash. So that right there, if it's true, I don't know if it is, but if it is, then that right there indicates that we really do need to improve the infrastructure. And with the economy being the way it is, you know, are we going to really, can we really think that that might be a feasible thing to do, Barb?
Oh. I don't pass on this.
Don't know. Okay.
I'm not all an right. economist, you know.
I understand. You're a streaming geek. Let me ask you this then, both of you. I'll start with you, Barb. If an ISP like Comcast starts charging, say, Netflix a premium for guaranteeing a certain amount of bandwidth, won't that also, and this is a sort of an economical question too, and I apologize for that. Won't that also mean that Comcast or Netflix then will then likely pass along that extra cost to its consumers?
Haven't you noticed we're getting a dollar a month raise in rates already?
On Netflix, you're right. It's gone from $7.99 to
$8.99. Yep. Dang. What's your
answer? I suppose so. Pardon me, if you don't want to answer this question, it's perfectly fine, but I'm curious to know, both of you have at least 100 megabits per second download speed into your homes. Mark, you're in Philly, so that's a pretty major metropolitan area. Barb, you're in a more rural area in Oregon, and I'm a little surprised that you can get that kind of fast internet. What kind of monthly rate are you paying for that? Give me a ballpark, a order of magnitude. I mean, are you paying $1,000 a month? Are you paying,
Well, firstly, I'm not rural. I'm more like suburban. I'm not out in the country. So that's number one. Number two, there's a couple things going on. Number two is I did have 100 megabits per second on a residential, but I had a cap of less than 200 gigabytes per month.
Ah.
And my streaming, it could have cost me like $500 a month. In fact, I had a bill or two like that and said, oh, my God. So I've actually moved into a business. I'm still getting the same 100 megabits per second download, but I have a really, really high cap. And for that, I am paying $175 a month.
That's not too bad.
Internet? I think that's
well
hot.
But it's 100 megabits per second. It's way more than I have at my house. I'm not paying that much.
It's actually 130 megabits per second is what is really coming down at this point. So, yeah. And I have a really high cap, so I can do all the streaming that I need to do for testing all my products. And so, so it's a little bit different. But the interesting thing is that was a locally owned business, Ben Broadband, and they have just sold out to some big cable company out of Chicago, which is huge news for our area. We're going to have some outsider running our business.
We'll see how that works. Mark, what's your situation? You have over 100 megabits, I think, right?
Sure. It's a Comcast residential service, and it's 150 megabit. It's got to cost about $100 a month. I try not to look at that bill. And Comcast's on a 300 gigabyte monthly cap, which I think they're going to start enforcing. It's been enough for me. So
even with all the streaming you do a lot of streaming because one of the things you do on AVS Forum that I love is comparing the stream from Vudu, from iTunes and so on to see which one does the best, has the best performance, looks the best, has the best sound. So you're streaming, the same movie two or three times.
Sure, but it would take 3 hours a day of continuous HD streaming at the highest bit rate on Vudu to use that up. So it's been enough regardless. It would be a bigger problem if it was the kind of file sizes that UHD video or let's say Blu-ray downloads, then I would definitely run out. But at current compression levels, watching 1080p streaming video, it hasn't, I haven't maxed out, not 1 month.
Well, now I sure have.
Even with your high cap, Barb, you've maxed out?
Oh, not on the new one. When I had 250 and 300, I would download HD movies, and I would do, between my family, I would do more than three high definition movies a day and all day long listening to, Google Play Music. And I could do it very, very easily.
Wow. Scott Michaud in the chat room, going back to a point I made earlier about if everybody went on Netflix at the same time, says if everybody went to Google at the same time without DNS caching, the internet would crash. So it's not really a good example. Okay, maybe it wasn't. It's just something that I heard somebody say.
Also, Netflix wouldn't be able to handle it.
Their servers would
at the same time. Their servers would die first.
There you go. Okay. Well, we've got, obviously net neutrality, and these issues are so important. I want to really point people to Barb's site, simpletechguru.com, where there are a list of questions that the FCC is seeking comments about from the public. So please do go there and check out those questions. You can also go to AVS Forum, where I point you to the actual FCC site to read the entire document, those of you who are not faint of heart. if you are, Simple Tech Guru is the place to go and get a digest of what they really want to know. And then go make some comments. I think this is really, really important. So I encourage everyone listening and watching this show to do exactly that. Now, another thing that we want to talk about today, that I want to talk about today, is a new streamer, which has come on the market. Of course, most people know about Roku, Chromecast. Both Barb and Mark have been on the show to talk about that. Apple TV. Now Amazon has gotten into the hardware game and introduced a streamer, a little streaming box called Fire TV. I myself have not yet played with it, but I know Barb and Mark both have. Barb, give us your overview of that particular device. What makes it different, better, worse than any of the other streamers you've used?
It's become my favorite.
Really?
It's absolutely become my favorite. And one reason is, if you haven't seen those Gary Busey commercials where he's yelling at the TV, you can do voice search. There's a good voice search. Not a great, but a good voice search. The quality of the picture is fantastic. And I actually have a Kindle Fire HDX, you know, one of the ebook kind of things.
One of their e-reader things, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's actually an Android type of tablet. And when you use that with the Kindle Fire TV, I tell you something, I don't want to use anything else. It is just so cool.
Really?
Yeah.
Obviously, this seems to me to be what they call the second screen experience. Or are you actually watching the content on the Kindle Fire?
It's a second screen experience. It's actually, when you go into the Amazon, there's so many cool things with this Kindle Fire. It's so cool. But when you go into the Amazon Instant Videos, you'll see X-ray. It'll say including X-ray. And this
what
is
that?
That's what this is, the second screen experience. And it is just better than anything else I've ever seen. So if you're playing on the Kindle, you're playing on the Fire TV, the Amazon Fire TV, you're playing a movie that's got X-ray, and you turn on the video app on the Kindle Fire, it will give you, it will give you trivia, it will give you what music is in a scene, and it'll tell you what actors, but it's like as it's going. So as an actor walks onto the screen, his face pops up on your tablet. Now, remember, IMDb is owned by Amazon.
Oh, so, I didn't know that. Interesting. IMDb, by the way, is the Internet Movie Database, where you can go and get information about just about any movie ever made.
Exactly. And you can see who's in the movie, and then you can get a list of their credits or filmography and get some more information about it all. So instead of, you know, what we used to do is somebody would walk on screen on a movie and we go, oh, what, that actor looks familiar. What else has he been in, or what's his name?
I do that all the time.
We don't have to look it up. You just look down at your screen and there's his face. You click on him and you get all the information right then and there. You could even move. Wow. You could even click on another movie and buy it, rent it, or put it in your watch list so that you could watch it later. And it's just hysterical to see the way people pop in and out. Like all of a sudden, as soon as they come on screen, it's like pops in, and as soon as they leave, they pop out of the screen scene. And so that's just it's amusing as well as being something that I use all the time. And another aspect is, okay, there's like background music, and it might be cool music. There's a movie I like called Holiday? Something. Whatever. And it has all this modern background music, and it's like, oh, what is that song? And like Mr. Brightside was one of the songs. So you can go to the song, the music section, see what that music is, and then, of course, click on it right away and buy it straight off from Amazon.
Wow. Well, this is also extremely cool because particularly modern movies very often commission songs from popular groups to like play during the credits,
exactly.
if not during the movie itself. And I often wonder, gee, who is that? What is that song? Was it written specifically for this movie, or did the producers of the movie just sort of license that song? And here you can just get all that information. This seems like the perfect definition of second screen experience.
Exactly.
That I have
thought. And yet there's more. Which,
and yet there's more.
Exactly. Well,
Before you get there, let me bring Mark in and just get his initial hit on it. I want to hear about what else you have That's learned fine. About Fire TV. But Mark, what was your initial experience with it? Do you have a Kindle Fire, or did you use another tablet with it?
I did not end up using a tablet with it. I do have an Android tablet. I had a Kindle Fire for a short period of time, but I found it too restrictive to be in the Amazon ecosystem on a tablet. But with the Fire TV, the Amazon's ecosystem makes a lot of sense, and it really, and you know, it makes for a very nice, I guess you just call it product. Now, I have a little problem, which is I don't necessarily love smart features, and I don't care that much about the second screen experience, and I'm very much more like image quality and sound quality oriented. And the end result is that I wound up giving the Fire TV to my mother, and she loves it. I gave her a Chromecast and she never used it. And she absolutely called me and was like, you know, I use the Fire TV and I love it. And I can see why, because it's not just easy, it's fast and it's intuitive. And if you're an Amazon Prime member, then there's a lot of value there. And if, you know, me personally, I like Vudu. And unfortunately, Amazon didn't include Vudu on the Fire TV. I guess it might have competed against their offerings. But Vudu has the larger library of movies that have 5.1 surround in 1080p. And it's pretty much the most important service to me. And it's like that's the one thing that killed the Fire TV.
It didn't. And the one thing that Fire TV didn't have. Well, that brings up an interesting point. All these different streamers like Fire TV, Apple TV, Roku, and so on, all offer you a different set of content providers. And there's quite a bit of overlap. They're all Netflix is on all of them, but sometimes not. For example, I'll give you an example, and either one of you can answer this. Last night, my wife and I happened to enjoy the show Castle with Nathan Fillion, and but we didn't watch it from the beginning, and so we wanted to start watching it from the beginning. So I tried to look it up in Netflix. It wasn't there at all. I looked it up in Hulu Plus, and they only have the latest season 6. We want to watch it from the very beginning. So this is a little slightly off the topic of Fire TV, but here's a personal question from me that I want to know. How can I go and find, the previous seasons of Castle or any other show, if somebody's more interested in something else, and do some binge watching, which is kind of a phrase that's used these days. Barb, what do you think?
Can I stream .it?
Can I stream .it? It?
Yes. You don't know that one?
I don't. Tell us, please.
It's a website. It's also an app. There you go. That's it. You put
it
in whatever
right
you
on.
Want. You type in your Castle right there.
Yep.
And it will tell you whether you have to pay for it, where it's available. It'll show you different ones. TVs movies.
You've just made my day.
that is fantastic.
That is fantastic. Wow.
I never heard of it either.
See, Mark, you and I.
Something new.
Exactly. You and I need to write about that on AVS Forum. We have to write about that. That is extremely cool. Well, thank you.
And it works. Yep.
Good. Then I will go look. I will go look after the show. So, Barb, then you were going to tell us some other cool things about Fire TV. Go for it.
And I will tell you a few more cool things, but I want to also address the search feature on Fire TV.
Okay.
That audio, you know, the it's got a microphone, so you can talk to it and say,
right.
You can say Castle. Now, it should tell you that you can watch it on Hulu and here and here and here, but it really isn't working quite right yet. And so it'll only tell you where you can rent it from Amazon. Pretty much. So it's kind of being a little playing favorites a little bit too much for my taste. But the other things that I wanted to talk about on the second screen was that you also had the trivia. So it might tell you a goof, like problems in continuity, or if it was a timepiece, these people shouldn't be wearing this, or it might tell you where the locations are, where it was filmed. Mm-hmm. And so you have all of that going in real time in each scene, or you can go through and look at a whole list of the songs, or the list of all the actors, or a list of everything else, and be able to go to that scene that relates to that list item, you know. Mm-hmm. And there's a really good scrub at the bottom. You can also do sort of that Chromecast thing where if you're watching it on TV and now you want to take it with you, you can now, stop it and then continue playing on your Kindle Fire and take it with you. So, mm-hmm. Or if you had a second Fire TV upstairs, then of course you could walk upstairs and, control it from up there as well. So there's all of that. And I think that the next step that Amazon's going to do is that they're going to make deals with people in movies and start selling cool items that you see in a movie. And you'll just be able to press on that on your Kindle Fire and immediately buy those shoes or whatever, right?
The next step in product placement, huh?
Yeah, I just really think that that's there. And I don't think it's a bad thing. Maybe I'm too consumer, but...
Well, there are several people in the chat room who are... talking about hating being tied down to one source. PCGuy8088 says, I hate being tied to one source of content, which the Fire TV does with its searching Amazon content only, as you were just saying. And also says, that's why I like my Roku. I have dozens of channels from a variety of content sources. So there is that.
Well, there are other channels, right?
On Fire TV, yes. But as you said, I guess, was it The Voice? Search, you can search. It'll only search Amazon.
Well, here's the thing.
Yes, Mark, go ahead.
In consideration of that versus the Chromecast, I wound up using my Sony Blu-ray player because it actually has Vudu and Amazon apps on it.
And, well, there you go.
I didn't get that from Google because I guess they don't want Amazon, or maybe it is. I don't believe that's on the Chromecast. I don't want to make a mistake on that one. But anyway, yeah, the point is that it's the combination of apps that maybe you already own the collection or that you have a preference for that I think determines the device that you wind up liking to a point. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's why Roku's so popular also.
So,
Barb, what do you think?
I'm looking at the list of what's on Fire TV. They have, and pardon me for looking because I have it written over here.
That's fine. No problem.
It's Netflix, Amazon Instant Video, Hulu Plus, Crackle, YouTube, HBO Go, Showtime Anytime, Watch ESPN, Bloomberg TV, Vivo, and Pandora. So I've been using for HBO Go and Hulu Plus. And there is a couple of things that I did a search for where it showed me that it was on Hulu Plus. Glee, I think, is what it was. It showed me that Glee was on Hulu Plus, and so I was able to go to it from there. So mm-hmm. It's supposed to work that way, but I don't think that Amazon has a lot of incentive to make it work correctly, you know?
Yeah, I suppose that's true. I wanted to also talk about the second screen experience a bit. And in my age bracket, I myself find it very difficult to divide my attention between a screen in my lap and my big screen in front of me, the TV or the projector. But my niece, who's in her mid-20s, can't sit there and just watch TV. She has to be on her computer or on a tablet or something doing multiple things at once. Is this a generational thing? Barb, what do you like the second screen experience? Do you look back and forth all the time?
Well, firstly, I think that you don't have ADD, so that's a good thing. but like I said, it's For me, it's not a continuous experience. It's having the information I want at my fingertips and being able to glance down and not having to stop what I'm watching so that I can look something up. you know? And that's what I like about this X-ray experience is that I don't have to go anywhere. I can just look down at it. Do I spend the whole time looking back and forth? No, that's not me. But I, you know, if it's a bad movie, I'll work on my computer.
Mark, you're a little younger than I am. Do you engage in what they call multitasking?
No, I get angry at people who multitask while I'm watching a movie, no matter where I am at home. I can't go to movie theaters. I just can't. Because one person pulls out a cell phone and that's what's got my attention, and I'm pulled out of the movie. So no, I try to read my IMDb and see what I should be catching when I'm watching the movie beforehand, or if I feel reasonably good about a movie, then I try to go into the movie, you know, with as little spoiler as possible. And I don't tend to rewatch movies, so, which I imagine is when you would really get into, you know, the second screen stuff.
Or if you're 25,
I mean, it never became relevant to the things that I did for AVS, because those are image and sound quality comparisons and don't really depend on trivia about actors or scenes.
True enough. Terry Kay in the chat room says it's an aging thing, which I think it is. Although I have to say, I don't believe that multitasking is a valuable thing, that it's not really multitasking, that you're code switching very quickly from one thing to another and not absorbing or getting as deep into any one of them, which to me, from my point of view, in my opinion, is not a positive thing. But of course, many people disagree with me, and that's okay. Well, listen, before we move on, I would like to take a moment to thank our sponsor for this episode, which is NatureBox.com. Now, look, it's easy to talk tough about eating right, but when you're starving at 3 p.m., like right about now, all cranky and lightheaded, the evil vending machine can seem like your only friend. Now, of course, I work at home, so there's no vending machine, but the kitchen is right around the corner, so it's the same thing. Don't give in. Keep your eye on looking and feeling great and head on over to naturebox.com/twit. Click on the continue button and choose between three subscription options, then place your order. What this is a snack subscription service. Once you're a member, you can select which snacks you'd like in your monthly box. You can select for your dietary needs, vegan, soy-free, gluten-conscious, lactose-free, nut-free, or non-GMO. You can also select by taste, savory, sweet, or spicy. NatureBox sends great-tasting snacks right to your door with free shipping anywhere in the U.S. Hey, we're talking healthy and satisfying snacks like banana bread granola, which I have tried and it's yummy, peppery pistachios, over 100 more. All with zero trans fats, zero high fructose corn syrup, and nothing artificial. NatureBox is the snack happy gift that keeps on giving, too, not only to yourself, but to your family or friends. Order a 3, 6, or 12-month subscription for that special someone. They will thank you. Hey, swimsuit weather is almost here. It's time to snack smarter. Forget the vending machine and get in shape with healthy, delicious treats like South Pacific plantains, which I just finished a bag of. So remember, to get 50% off your first box, go to naturebox.com/twit. Stay full, stay strong. Go to naturebox.com/twit. And we thank NatureBox very much for their support of the Home Theater Geeks show. And for my snacking. Now, the other thing I wanted to talk about today, Barb, you actually brought it up and had some strong opinions about it. So let's see what it is. It's a new service called QPlay. And the website is qplay.co, not qplay.com. What's that all about?
I don't have any idea why they have .co other than that .com was probably taken. But what it is actually a new adapter and app that has
been invented or co-founded by the co-founders who created TiVo. And they decided they're going to revolutionize the way that we stream over-the-top videos on the over the internet. What it is that you're creating or you're watching cues, you know, like watch lists. And those cues have been, you can curate your own cues, but they have curated cues or the cues of other users. So it's a social experience. And they play sort of continuously unless you decide to choose certain videos here and here and here. So they might have these, the most popular or the trending, they might have a cue on travel or comedy or other things that you might be interested in. You can link your Twitter account or your Facebook account or your YouTube subscriptions, and each of those become their own cues. But it's just really strange because it plays continuously. As soon as you open, the adapter has to work with the Qplay app.
Okay, and so let's first of all, let's make sure we understand this. Make sure right. I understand this and the rest of the audience. You download an app to your iPad. iPhone. It's iPad. Only Apple? It's only iOS?
Not 100% sure, but...
from what I saw on the website... Right now it is. Yeah, that's what I saw on the website as well. So you download the app, my understanding from what little I saw on the website was if you want to show the cues on your TV, you need this little hardware box.
Right. This little kind of dumb adapter that you're just hooking up, you know, does 1080p and 5.1. And it's $50 for the adapter. But there is absolutely no controlling the adapter. It's sort of dumb like a Chromecast. It's very small, about the size of a deck of cards, and you hook it up to your TV. And
the only way HDMI, I presume.
Yes. Sorry. And to your TV and to power, you have to use a USB.
I have to power it as well. Power. Okay, fine.
Mm-hmm. And then, so that's going to get what you have on your iPad onto the TV. Now, it is not streaming from the iPad to the TV. When you choose the video in the Qplay app, that video is actually living in the Qplay cloud. So when you choose it on your app, it tells the adapter to go to the Qplay cloud and stream from the Qplay cloud. The advantage of that, of course, is that you can now use your iPad to do other things, and it's not reliant on the streaming to the iPad. Does that make sense?
Well, it's very confusing. It is kind of confusing, but let me ask you this. So the content is coming to this this little dumb interface box by Wi-Fi? Is there an internet? I mean, a Ethernet port on it?
It's on. You use the app to connect the Qplay to your internet. And the app and the Qplay have to be on the same internet, the same Wi-Fi.
Network. Yeah.
The same network. So I guess
but the content is not streaming from the iPad to the Qplay device.
Right.
As it would, say, with Chromecast or the...
No, Chromecast isn't either, remember?
Oh, that's right.
Chromecast is using that dial, which Mark is so good at explaining.
Is there a private aspect to that, or is it all like the videos go into this big queue and then anybody can watch like sort of like what you are interested in as if it was a channel? Like, is it social like that? Like always
yes.
Social or
I don't know if I don't know if you can block your thing. I'm sure you can.
But the reason everything's online is so that basically anybody can watch the lists that you've put together. Your playlists,
or their playlist that they came
or
up
their
with,
playlists,
right?
Right.
So yeah, I mean, it's sort of like Spotify, where you could follow people. I haven't found where you can make your queue private, but when you watch another queue, that doesn't go into some kind of watch list that shows other people what you've been watching. The only thing that would be your queue would be a queue that you've added your favorites to and added to your own queue. So you're really just watching other queues that are out there. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. Now, you said also that this is not intended to watch like a movie or a TV show. It's what, video background?
It just
plays continuously whatever's in the queue.
Okay, so this is where we go from here. Okay, so it right. is most it's mostly short form videos, mostly under 10-minute videos. Although there are queues that have things like Twit TV, and
right.
Those are the better queues. But when you go to the app and you just kind of are looking around for what's new or for what's most popular, firstly, as soon as you go to the app, it immediately starts playing. The idea, I'm told from Qplay, is that it's like TV. When you turn on the TV, or like a TV channel, TV is just playing. So instead of watching TV in the background while you're doing your dishes or whatever, you can have these videos going in the background. And they're short form and they're aggregated, but not necessarily curated. And the reason I make a point of that is that when I had it on, there were so many bad videos I wanted to gouge my eyeballs out. I mean, the guy who tells his girlfriend that there's lipstick on the rug so that she comes in the other room so he can get proposed to her was like the dumbest video ever. Sorry, guy, if you were watching this. But I was like, there were so many bad videos, one after another, after another, after another. And the conversation I was having with the CEO is that why would I want good videos if I'm going to watch something. This is pretty much more video noise. And he was saying that the millennials, which clearly I'm not, they like to watch these short form videos one after another after another. And that this gives them that opportunity. And he actually insinuated that these videos were more authentic and entertaining than the stuff that you might watch on TV and movies. I found that to be a ridiculous concept because, I mean, if that's really true, then we should stop paying people like Marty Scorsese for making films, right?
Oh, yeah. YouTube on random, right? I mean, that's all you need. YouTube on random play.
Can YouTube do that? I haven't actually tried that.
Yeah,
I don't think so.
What they do
but
have
it would be a good idea. But it's kind of what this is then. If there's a YouTube queue, then that may very well be what it is. Perhaps you could even go in and say YouTube cat videos.
Yeah, you can make YouTube queues, but
go ahead, Mark.
I don't know. I'm just saying that that's what it sounds like to me is just what people get out of, like, the Chromecast Advanced was that you could create a queue of YouTube videos, which are those short form, like, just entertainments. And I spent a couple nights doing that. It was fun, but it wasn't like I'm going to make that my hobby. And I'm just trying to relate in the sense that this device sounds like it constantly serves that up.
Well, you're not actually creating your own queues. They're curating them for you.
Right.
And it's not just YouTube. It's stuff from all over the internet. It could be anything from Nat Geo channel to Vimeo to Vine to anything that is gotcha. Put in there. You're not curating your own queue other than when you add favorites and add them to your own queue. So
does it have like a smart function? Does it learn what you like?
No.
So that it no. Ooh.
There's nothing about what you like. It's about giving you what's there. But now, there is, however, once I was talking to them, I found out that there was like this little button over in the corner where you could press and actually get some decent channels, things like, you know, Condé Nast publications and Twit TV and, you know, different kind of channels that have decent, for, to me, what I consider decent, actually produced kind of videos that might be of real interest to me. Like, you know, Wall Street Journal news and things like that, rather than, you know, some guy who has a YouTube video up and is kind of talking about what he thinks is good. But I'm told that it's what all the millennials want. Now, my son is a millennial, and he is much more discreet in his watching. He doesn't think that this sounds like a good idea either.
Well, SoundPro69 in the chat room has a couple of comments and questions here. What Barb is describing about the app connecting directly to the source sounds like what the Chromecast does when you call a stream to it from a Nexus device, right?
No. It's close. I mean, I think, like I said, Mark can probably describe Dial better than I can about how it, what Dial is really telling it a URL to go to. But what I'm told from Qplay is that they actually load the videos onto their cloud servers. So you're actually getting it from their cloud servers. It's revolutionary because it's really hard to understand.
Well, then it must be revolutionary.
Exactly.
Mark, what's your response to this?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure I would want that device in my house. it's contrary to my viewing habits. I'm a cable cutter, and as noted, my preferred viewing is a full movie with no interruptions.
But what about SoundPro69's question about that this sounds like what Chromecast does when you call a stream to it from a Nexus device? First of right all, can on. You well, explain what that does?
Well, as Barb said, Dial creates a direct link between the Chromecast and the website that's serving the data. And as she's describing it, Qplay is somehow diverting, like basically it's taking that Dial command and sending that signal to their server and then streaming that to you. I don't know what the exact reason for that would be, but probably the lucid, like the quick switching between the channels or however it works. I haven't seen it, so I can't comment in that specific sense. But I gather that Dial makes a direct connection between the device and the service that you're going to watch and cuts everything in between out. Here you've obviously got some kind of a middleman server that's adding value to it, or at least adding value to it if you're a millennial.
Yes, exactly. SoundPro69 also says that rolling of short video seems like what the Vivo or Vimeo apps do on the Roku. What do you guys think about that?
I haven't noticed that it just plays on. I don't know.
Okay. SoundPro69 also says, it's about feeding you what they can't sell to anyone else. Nice.
Yeah, I'm going to spend money on that.
Exactly.
Channel flipping existed. No. I was just going to say channel flipping certainly existed.
Long before this.
Phenomenon. Yeah.
It's true. But now this is automatic channel flipping where you don't have to actually push a button. You don't have to push the clicker. Anybody remember when remotes used to be called clickers?
Yes, I can, and that's probably why I would not like the Qplay.
Because those early remotes actually made a clicking sound because they used ultrasonic frequencies to tell the TV to mechanically change the channel changer.
My Very family's funny. First color Trinitron had a clicker remote, I remember.
Yep, exactly so. Web3762... has been asking here a couple of times, and I apologize for not getting to it sooner. Do you guys have any sense of whether we will ever see a Netflix app on OS X, OS X, Mac operating system that isn't jerky? He says the browser playback frame rate is rather jerky, either via Netflix, either Ethernet or Fios. He's got 15.5. I don't watch streaming on my Mac particularly. I just use Apple TV or Roku or whatever. Have you guys had any experience trying to watch Netflix on an OS X device, not an iOS device, and seen this problem?
Well, the problem that I've seen and what I've learned is the problem for me is that unless you have a really, really new Mac, too many resources are being used on other stuff. So anything that is being jerky in Safari, if you're watching it in Safari and such, it could be that you have photo apps or other apps that are using a lot of your resources. And so it's really actually the computer that's having the problem rather than it being the Netflix service. Now, the other thing is that the Netflix service is going to know that you're coming from a computer and isn't going to send you as high a quality stream as it will send to your Roku box because it knows where it's sending it to.
Hmm. Well, that makes sense, especially since Hulu can tell whether or not you're watching on a computer, in which case it'll show you its content. But if you go to it from a web browser on a streaming box, it won't show it to you. So,
and you do know that Hulu is now going to be free. You can stream Hulu free to mobile devices.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yep.
You got to read that column. I do have to read your column. No, you're right. You're right.
A couple weeks ago.
Okay. All right. All right. Mark, have you ever had any are you a Mac guy or a Windows guy? I forget.
I'm actually a Windows guy. I've had similar problems playing Netflix through a browser in Windows, but now Netflix has a dedicated app for Windows 8 that works properly and delivers the Super HD. You know, that's their top tier streaming speed. But I do use my Sony Blu-ray player as my primary streaming device. For various reasons, 7.1 audio with, you know, when it's supported instead of 5.1 and just generally, smooth streaming from Netflix. I never had an easy time streaming Netflix directly on my PC or PCs, plural.
Web3762 is saying this happens even on fairly high spec MacBooks. So what Barb was saying about maybe the computer is too busy doing other stuff might not be relevant in his particular case. Darkroom08 in the chat room is asking, how well does Fire TV support local content DVD and Blu-ray ISO playback? Can it even do that?
What?
if you have a Blu-ray or DVD ripped onto your computer, will it play local content on your network?
I don't think that it plays local content other than something that might be on your Kindle. I don't think that it is a local content kind of thing. I don't remember seeing any apps.
What do you think, Mark?
Does it support Plex? I thought it supported Plex, which is kind of local.
If it does, then you don't think it supports Plex? Well, we'll have to do some research on it.
I'm looking.
Okay. Go take a look and see what you think there, because that is kind of an important function for a lot of people who watch this show and who read AVS Forum, they've got a lot of content on a network-attached storage server.
Plex blog says Plex is available on Amazon's Fire TV.
There you go.
That's a yes.
So the answer is, there you go. It can do it, but how good is it? You guys will have to figure out, and I will too. I'm actually going to get one myself. I really should, because I am an Amazon Prime member, and it would be worth it for me to have that so that I can take a look and see what Amazon Prime might provide me. Maybe they have back episodes of Castle. Well, listen, we've come to the end of a great hour. I want to thank you both for being here. Fascinating conversation about all the latest and greatest in streaming and online content, second screen experience. Man, we covered a lot of ground today. Thanks so much. Barb Gonzalez, the Simple Tech Guru at simpletechguru.com. Thank you so much for being here.
Well, Well, thanks a lot. And I really want to ask people to follow me on Facebook at Simple Tech Guru. And then you'll be able to find out things like when Hulu becomes free.
Okay, Mommy.
Thanks for having me on.
It's my pleasure. And Mark Henninger, of course, my colleague at avsforum.com, writes all kinds of really great stuff there. Thanks so much again for being on.
Totally a pleasure. Thanks, Scott.
You bet. You can find Mark, of course, at avsforum.com. Also, his own website, imagicdigital.com. And Barb is at simpletechguru.com and also a columnist at soundandvision.com. Of course, you can find me at avsforum.com. You can email me at scott@twit.tv. And you can follow me on Twitter at htgeekscott. And you can also find previous episodes of Home Theater Geeks right here at twit.tv/htg or on YouTube at youtube.com/twithometheatergeeks. But I do hope you'll make the effort to watch us live, because then you can join in the chat room and maybe get your question asked on the air and discussed by the panelists. Next week, my guest geek is scheduled to be Joel Silver, the president of the Imaging Science Foundation, to talk about the, believe it or not, the newly standardized gamma specification for televisions. Now, this is about as geeky as it gets, so we will try to make it digestible to those of you who might not be television engineers, but it's a very important subject for those of us who are who care about video quality, so I do hope you will join me then. Until then, geek out.